Good morning, Gospel of Grace Church. It's a beautiful day. It's wonderful to see everyone gathered together to worship our Lord. But before we get to the call of worship, I'd like to give a few announcements. First, the Women's Bible Study will be this Tuesday at 10 a.m. at Tatiana Bondaruk's house in Bridgewater. The other announcement I have is Friday Night Bible Study will be this week at the Verona Community Center at 7. And the youth will be meeting at Dmitry Bondaruk's house at 6 until 8 this Wednesday. And make sure to come because it'll be the last meeting until September. Also, if you're a guest, we just want to welcome you. Welcome to our church and hope you enjoy worshiping with us this morning. If you do have any questions about our church, there are info packets in the back that you're welcome to get. And anybody, one of the brothers, will be happy to talk to you afterwards as well. And with that being said, would everybody be willing to rise and we'll read from Psalm 99, verses 1 through 5 for our call to worship. And I will be reading from the Legacy Standard Bible. Yahweh reigns, let the peoples tremble. He sits enthroned above the cherubim, let the earth quake. Yahweh is great in Zion, and he is exalted above all the peoples. Let them praise your great and awesome name. Holy is he. The strength of the king loves justice. You have established equity. You have done justice and righteousness in Jacob. Exalt Yahweh, our God, and worship at the footstool of his feet. Holy is he. Let us pray. Our holy and heavenly Father, we come before you this morning to worship your name, to exalt at your footstool, to come both to the cross and to the throne, and to bring our worship, to bring our service, to lay down at the foot of Christ, our King, and Lord, you, our Father. We acknowledge that you are holy in a world that is fallen and wicked, in a world that deserves your justice. But what a wonderful justice your righteousness is. That you know goodness, and you are goodness, and you expect goodness of your creation. And Lord, while we fall short, you have provided a means by which we can be called your children, and we can come and we can worship, free of our sin, covered by the blood of Christ. And Father, we pray and look forward to the day when the justice which this passage speaks of will come in the presence of our King, in person. We look forward to the coming of your kingdom, Lord. And today, we recognize you as we wait. We honor your name, and we ask that you honor our attempt at a worship as we sing, as we hear your word preached. Father, may you help us. May you make good our worship, for we are incapable of any good apart from you. So, Lord, be with us. Be with our hearts. Open them to your word. Be with Adam as he brings the word to help him in his speech, and as well with the musicians, and as we sing along, may you give us that power to worship your name in holiness as you are holy. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Hallelujah, amen. Let all with heart grace of God has reached for me and pulled me from the raging sea. And I am safe on the solid ground. The Lord is my salvation. I will not fear when darkness falls. His strength will help me scale these walls. I'll see the dawn of the rising sun. The Lord is my salvation. Who is like Great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning with thee. Thou changest not thy compassions, they fail not. As thou hast been, thou forever will be. Great is thy
If you're able and willing, would you please remain standing for scripture reading? We are consecutively reading through the New Testament, and today our passage is going to be found in Revelation chapter 12. A great sign appeared in heaven, a woman clothed with the sun and the moon under her feet, and on her head a crown of 12 stars, and she was with child. And she cried out, being in labor and in pain to give birth. Then another sign appeared in heaven, and behold, a great red dragon having 7 heads and 10 horns, and on his heads were seven diadems. And his tail swept away a third of the stars of heaven and threw them to the earth. And the dragon stood before the woman who was about to give birth, so that when she gave birth, he might devour her child. And she gave birth to a son, a male child, who is to rule all the nations with a rod of iron. And her child was caught up to God and to his throne. Then the woman fled into the wilderness, where she had a place prepared by God, so that there she would be nourished for 1,260 days. And there was war in heaven, Michael and his angels waging war with the dragon. The dragon and his angels waged war, and they were not strong enough, and there was no longer a place found for them in heaven. And the great dragon was thrown down, the serpent of old, who is called the devil and Satan, who deceives the whole world. He was thrown down to the earth, and his angels were thrown down with him. Then I heard a loud voice in heaven saying, "Now the salvation and the power and the kingdom of our God and the authority of his Christ have come, for the accuser of our brethren has been thrown down, he who accuses them before God day and night. And they overcame him because of the blood of the Lamb and because of the word of their testimony. And they did not love their life even when faced with death. For this reason, rejoice, O heavens, and you who dwell in them. Woe to the earth and to the sea, because the devil has come down to you, having great wrath, knowing that he has only a short time." And when the dragon saw that he was thrown down to the earth, he persecuted the woman who gave birth to the male child. But the two wings of the great eagle were given to the woman so that she could fly into the wilderness to her place, where she was nourished for a time and times and half a time from the presence of the serpent. And the serpent poured water like a river out of his mouth after the woman, so that he might cause her to be swept away with the flood. But the earth helped the woman, and the earth opened its mouth and drank up the river which the dragon poured out of his mouth. So the dragon was enraged with the woman and went off to make war with the rest of her children, who keep the commandments of God and hold to the testimony of Jesus. Let's pray. Oh, Heavenly Father, you are a great God. You're the creator of the universe. You're the eternal one who knows everything, who's all powerful, who has a perfect plan and is accomplishing it according to your will. We thank you that we can call you our Father because the Holy Spirit dwells in us. We are drawn to you with our love, with our gratitude, with our acknowledgement that we are unworthy and incapable of saving ourselves. But our trust is in Christ, the Lamb of God, who poured out his blood so that we would be redeemed and atoned for. And you gave us this privilege to come to this throne and to cry out, Abba, Father. And we have this wonderful opportunity to come together as a church body and to pray to you. Lord, we thank you for that. We thank you for the words that we just read that describes your plan and what you will allow to happen on this earth, and how Israel was the woman who gave birth to Christ, our Lord, and how Satan tried to destroy our Lord Jesus, but he couldn't. We also are told of his angels. A third of the heavenly hosts were swept by him from heaven, and they were cast down. Lord, we know that we live in this world where there is a spiritual warfare. Satan and his demons are trying to cause affliction, trying to enslave people. And if it wasn't for your protection on our lives, all of us would be in danger and none of us would be strong enough to fight the temptations or to fight the demons that are all around us. But we thank you, Lord, that you have also given us this promise through our brother Apostle John, who said, greater is he who's in you than he who's in the world. And so we Christians who possess the Holy Spirit that dwells in us, we are secure. We don't have to fear Satan and his evil ones because we know that we belong to you and we are ultimately protected by your sovereign power. Lord, we are reminded with what awaits Israel and how Satan will be enraged against them and how there will be a great tribulation. Father, we also thank you that you have saved us from your wrath, that there would be no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus, and that we will not have to experience the tribulation that will be poured out on this world. Lord, we are grateful for your grace towards us. We thank you that you have chosen us, saved us, and gave us a promise of eternal life, that he who believes in him shall not perish, but will have everlasting eternal life. Thank you for that promise. So, Lord, as we worship you today, we desire to exalt your name. We desire to honor you with obedience to your word, not because it earns us your favor or it earns us our salvation, but because we desire to do this out of gratitude for what you have done on our behalf. Lord, we also know you also know of our needs. We have members of our church who are experiencing physical pain, especially pray for Barbara, who was involved in this accident. Pray that you would give her healing, that you would comfort Sergi and the kids, that you would give them, and Barbara as well, that you would just give them patience and endurance to go through this trial, and that through it all they would glorify you. There are other members in our church who are experiencing various illnesses. Pray that you would give them healing according to your will, Lord. But there's also people in our church who are experiencing emotional pain and spiritual afflictions. Father, give us protection. Give us your grace. Those who belong to you, we know that you promise that you will never leave us nor forsake us. Pray that you would give us the words and the thoughts that we need to be comforted, to be secure in our salvation, and to be secure in that you know what you're doing and that all things work together for good. Lord, we pray for our community. It is very common for people to call themselves believers and yet have absolutely no idea who Christ is. We desire to know you more and more, Lord Jesus. Our eternal life, it's all about you. It's all about the Father. And we thank you that you have revealed who you are through the pages of Scripture. But unless you open our spiritual eyes, those who read your word, they will not be impacted by it. And so we pray that you would open the spiritual eyes of people around us and that they would see the glorious truth of the gospel, that they would be drawn to repentance and obedience to Christ. Father, I thank you for Adam and his preparation. And I do pray that you would bless him as he comes out to preach your word. Prepare our hearts to hear and obey what you will say to us today. Lord, may you remove any distraction, anything that hinders us from following you closely. Lord, we pray that through this whole time of worship, that your name would be glorified, our saints would be edified, and those who don't know you yet, those would be drawn closer to you to see that you are the Lord Jesus who can save sinners. We thank you and we praise you. It's in your name we pray, Lord Jesus. Amen.
Continue singing together. Yes, continue singing together for the Lord and for one another. I want to encourage us to continue to rejoice in the Lord and Savior and King. And it's okay to turn to the side and maybe even wave to one another. Show your affections, show your joy on your faces. I think we all, or majority of us, need to grow in that. Rejoice, the Lord is King.
Good morning. It was kind of a neat bit of providential timing that our scripture reading lined up with what we're going to study this morning. It mentioned the birth of Jesus, and we're going to discuss the incarnation of Christ, probably not in the way that you are anticipating, but that will be our subject. If you want to turn to Hebrews chapter 2, that's where we'll draw our stuff from. Hebrews chapter 2. Now, I don't know how much thought you have given to the incarnation of Christ, but it's a strange doctrine. I think we have to admit that. It's a little weird. The idea that the God of the universe would come down to earth and take on human flesh in order to redeem his creation that has rejected him and that has rebelled against him. It doesn't make a whole lot of sense, because we think about it through the mind of fallen humanity, who, if we were put in that same situation, we would disown or destroy our creation. And, you know, just thinking about it, human to human, in our interactions, I mean, when was the last time you heard of a king or a president that humbled himself to do the maid's job, you know, just to pick up a toilet brush and start scrubbing. You know, even at that level, it, you know, that kind of thing just doesn't happen. Now, I realize those are weak analogies that don't even come close to comparing to what Jesus did. But I think those are the kinds of connections we make in our mind when we try to understand the incarnation. So it doesn't make a lot of sense to us. And then when you amplify the scale of condescension, you know, the distance that God humbled himself to take on the lowly human state, it becomes rather difficult for us to wrap our heads around that doctrine. You know, God in human flesh. You know, it's not that mankind has progressed to such a high level of understanding that, you know, the doctrine has become difficult to comprehend, as if we've outgrown it in our development in human thinking. Evidently, this is something that the Hebrew audience was struggling to firmly grasp and believe. As persecution was ratcheting up and they were thinking about what beliefs they were being persecuted for, this doctrine seems to be one that they were failing to see the significance of and were willing to compromise on. But it's not a doctrine that can be compromised on. It's absolutely critical. If you remove just this one bolt from the structure of salvation, the whole thing collapses. And so you can't do away with this doctrine and hang on to the rest of salvation. It just doesn't work that way. And in our passage this morning, the author of Hebrews is going to explain the incarnation. Not in the sense that we'll come any closer to understanding how it worked, you know, how God squeezed himself into a human body. That's going to remain a mystery, or at least one I can't explain for you. But he's going to explain the significance of Christ taking on human flesh, which is helpful for us in terms of appreciating the condescension of the second member of the Trinity. Now, it's been a little while since we've been in Hebrews, so Let me remind you of the context and kind of the flow of the letter up to this point. Hebrews is written to predominantly Jewish believers who are experiencing persecution for their faith. And some are considering returning back to Judaism because Judaism was a recognized religion by the Roman government, and so it offered some protection against persecution. And the author writes this letter to urge these professing believers to consider what it would mean to turn back. And in short, it would mean abandoning the gospel and that their faith was never genuine in the first place. And it would mean forfeiting their souls. And so there's a pretty significant consequence to what it is that they are considering. And the main point of compromise seems to be on their understanding of the person and work of Christ, as if it were possible to sort of suppress that aspect of the gospel, maybe return to some Jewish ritualism, and then they could maintain salvation and avoid persecution. And the author rightly explains throughout this letter that that's not a possibility. Christ is the center of salvation, and if you do away with him, you lose salvation altogether. Now, the majority of the letter is the author demonstrating how Jesus is better than various prized aspects of the Jewish faith. And the Jews were not wrong to hold in high regard the things that God had given them as ways to worship him and to demonstrate their trust in him. But in the chronology of redemptive history, those rituals have now become obsolete. And Christ has superseded them. But the Hebrews were trying to go back to those things and convince themselves that God would still accept those same discontinued rituals as appropriate acts of worship. And as a way of justifying that, they seem to have adopted the idea that since the Old Testament scriptures were mediated through angels, then it held more weight than Jesus because he was just a man. and so therefore his gospel doesn't hold as much weight. And in chapter 1 and 2, the author has been explaining why Jesus is better than the angels, and our passage this morning wraps up that argument. So let's read the passage, Hebrews chapter 2, beginning in verse 5. It says, "For he did not subject to angels the world to come, concerning which we are speaking. But one has testified somewhere, saying, 'What is man that you remember him? Or the son of man that you are concerned about him? You have made him for a little while lower than the angels. You have crowned him with glory and honor, and have appointed him over the works of your hands. You have put all things in subjection under his feet. For in subjecting all things to him, he left nothing that is not subjected to him. But now we do not yet see all things subjected to him. But we do see him who was made for a little while lower than the angels, namely Jesus, because of the suffering of death, crowned with glory and honor, so that by the grace of God he might taste death for everyone. For it was fitting for him, for whom are all things and through whom are all things, in bringing many sons to glory, to perfect the author of their salvation through sufferings. For both he who sanctifies and those who are sanctified are all from one Father, for which reason he is not ashamed to call them brethren, saying, I will proclaim your name to my brethren. In the midst of the congregation, I will sing your praise. And again, I will put my trust in him. And again, behold, I and the children whom God has given me. Therefore, since the children share in flesh and blood, he himself likewise also partook of the same, that through death he might render powerless him who had the power of death, that is the devil, and might free those who through fear of death were subject to slavery all their lives. For assuredly he does not give help to angels, but he gives help to the descendant of Abraham. Therefore, he had to be made like his brethren in all things, so that he might become a merciful and faithful high priest in things pertaining to God, to make propitiation for the sins of the people. For since he himself was tempted in that which he has suffered, he is able to come to the aid of those who are tempted." Verse 5 starts with the word "for," which it introduces an explanation that reaches back to the end of chapter 1. Chapter 2, verses 1 through 4 is kind of a parenthesis where the author has demonstrated the supremacy of Christ, and then he stops his argument and he gives an exhortation. And the exhortation is, since Christ is so great, you should listen to him. His rank gives his words authority, which cannot be ignored without consequence. And then after he finishes that exhortation, he picks back up with his argument of how Jesus is greater than the angels in verse 5. If we start reading back in chapter 1, verse 13, it says, But to which of the angels has he ever said, sit at my right hand until I make your enemies a footstool for your feet? Are they not all ministering spirits sent out to render service for the sake of those who will inherit salvation? And then if you skip down to verse 5, for he did not subject to angels the world to come, concerning which we are speaking. And so the flow of thought there makes sense if you pull that out as a parenthesis. In verse 13 of chapter 1, he's describing the kingdom of Christ. And then in verse 5 of chapter 2, he says, I'm talking about the world to come. And so he's referring back to what he was saying earlier. And in chapter 1, verse 14, he says that angels are ministering spirits, serving those who will inherit salvation. And then from chapter 2, verse 5 on, he's going to explain salvation through the incarnate Christ. And so we're going to look at explaining the incarnation. And the first point is a fallen condition. The incarnation can be explained by a fallen condition. In chapter 1, verse 14, we learn that angels are ministering spirits. They serve the saints. And then here in chapter 2, verse 5, the world to come has not been made subject to them. And the idea is that they will not have authority over Christ's kingdom. And the contrast that the author is setting up is that humanity has been given authority in Christ's kingdom. Angels haven't, humanity has. However, there's a problem. Humanity is not what it should be. It has fallen from what God has designed it to be and needs to be redeemed and restored. The author introduces this problem by quoting from Psalm chapter 8, but the way that he introduces the quote is interesting. He says, one has testified somewhere. What is that? Somebody somewhere. I mean, come on, author. He knows that this is a psalm that was written by David. The letter is filled with Old Testament quotes. I think it's like at least 30 plus almost 100 in total are referenced in some way. And so he has an impressive command of the Old Testament, and he's also inspired by the Holy Spirit as he's writing this. And so why doesn't he give a citation here? And it's not just that he doesn't give the citation, he obscures the citation. He seems to be dismissing the citation. It doesn't really matter. And in fact, he doesn't really cite any of his Old Testament references, of which, like I said, there are many. And so he's obviously doing this intentionally, but why? What's he trying to accomplish here by kind of ignoring the person that wrote it? Well, he's underscoring the divine author of Scripture. If these were just David's words, they don't carry any authority. If they were just Moses' words, they don't have any authority. So what he's doing by ignoring the human author is highlighting the divine author. And the point that he's making is that the Old Testament, in its entirety, no matter where he draws from, is the authoritative word of God. And I think he does that so that his audience can't reject some of the biblical proof that he's going to give just because they don't like the author. I mean, if you remember the Sadducees and the Gospels, they only adhered to the first five books of Moses, or the first five books of the Bible, all of which were written by Moses. And so if it wasn't written by Moses, they rejected it. They didn't accept it as God's word. We don't have to follow that. We don't have to do anything with it. And I think the same type of dodge still happens today. You know, people will say, that's Old Testament. Or, it only says it one time. Or, Paul wrote that and he was a male chauvinist, so we don't have to pay attention to him. But the author of Hebrews bypasses any bias that his audience might have, and he attributes all of the Old Testament scriptures to the Lord. And since it is the word of God, they and we must accept it as authoritative. And so he quotes God's word in chapter 6. He says, what is man that you remember him, or the son of man that you are concerned about him? You have made him for a little while lower than the angels. You have crowned him with glory and honor and have appointed him over the works of your hands. You have put all things in subjection under his feet. And here the author is quoting from Psalm chapter 8, and directly before the quote, David was thinking about the Lord's creation in the heavens. He's thinking about the moon and the stars and all of the stuff that's out there. And it causes him to compare the splendor of the heavens with, the lackluster of mankind. In comparison to heaven's size and greatness, humanity is relatively unimpressive. And so he asks the Lord, Lord, why do you care about us? Of what value is man that you remember him and that you are concerned about him? In comparison to the vastness of your creation, you have chosen to put your love and concern on humanity. And then he details a few ways that God has shown his unique care for humanity. He has made us a little lower than the angels, in the sense that angels are spiritual and we are earthly. One commentator said that angels are stronger than humans, but not omnipotent like God. They are greater than humans in knowledge, but not omniscient like God. They are swifter and more mobile than humans, but not omnipresent like God. And so angels are impressive beings to be sure, but in the pecking order of God's creation, we're right below them. And God has crowned humanity with glory and honor by giving him dominion over the earth. In essence, we were made to be kings of the world. Look back at Genesis chapter 1 for a second. Genesis chapter 1, verse 26 says, "Then God said, 'Let us make man in our image, according to our likeness, and let them rule over the fish of the sea, and over the birds of the sky, and over the cattle, and over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creeps on the earth.' God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created him. Male and female, he created them. God blessed them, and God said to them, 'Be fruitful and multiply, and fill the earth, and subdue it, and rule over the fish of the sea, and over the birds of the sky, and over every living thing that moves on the earth.'" And this is what David was referring to when he talks about all things being put in subjection under mankind's feet. We were made to rule over the earth. You know, angels can flitter back and forth between heaven and earth, but we have been given authority over everything that God has made within the earthly realm. And the author even reiterates that point by saying that God left nothing that isn't subject to humanity. This was God's design for mankind, that we would rule over his creation. You know, we are made in the image of God, and part of that image is dominion over the earth and over everything that God has created to live on it. But as the author points out at the end of verse 8, "But now we do not yet see all things subjected to him." So God designed us to be rulers, but something happened, and that is no longer the case. Now, the author of Hebrews doesn't elaborate on that, but we all know what happened. You know, Adam and Eve rebelled from the Lord, and sin entered the world. And just as they rebelled against their God, the earth and its creatures rebelled against humanity as their king. The ground was cursed. It fights against humanity, growing thorns and thistles, making it more difficult for us to just eke out a living. The animals, they fear mankind. Some, their fear causes them to be hostile and aggressive towards humans. Of far more significance is the destruction that sin has done to humanity's relationship with God. Because of sin, mankind now experiences death and separation from the Lord. The crown of glory and honor has fallen. But look again at the end of verse 8. Notice there's a little word there. It says yet. We do not yet see all things subjected to him. The author, he's dropping a little hint that this discouraging situation will change. It will change because of the work of a suffering substitute. In explaining the incarnation, we unfortunately find ourselves in a fallen condition, and we have need of a suffering substitute who can redeem and restore us. Excuse me. And so we don't see mankind with all things subjected under him like God designed us to be, but verse 9 says we do see Jesus crowned with glory and honor. And there's a contrast between the sad state of man and the glorified condition of Jesus. And there's also a connection between verse 7, where we were crowned with glory and honor, and the glory and honor that we can now see in Jesus Christ. So Where did that glory and honor come from? Why is this Jesus, whom the Hebrews are wishy-washy on, why is he crowned with glory and honor? Philippians chapter 2, verses 6 and 7 say that though Jesus existed as God, he did not cling to, he did not hold to his deity, but emptied himself, not in the sense that he became less God, but that he took on the form of a bondservant and was made in the likeness of men. So the author of Hebrews says it this way: he was made for a little while lower than the angels. And so again, we have this connection back to humanity in verse 7. God's design for man was that he would be a little lower than the angels. Jesus, the Almighty God of the universe, condescends and for a time was made a little lower than the angels. And so the author is describing the incarnation of Christ, the God-man Jesus. He is crowned with glory and honor because of his suffering death, he says. And the purpose of his suffering death was so that he could taste death for everyone. He could stand in man's place, taking the punishment that we deserve. Jesus took on human flesh. He lived a sinless life, was crucified in the place of sinners, and has risen from the dead. And chapter 1, verse 3 of Hebrews says that when he had made purification of sins, he sat down at the right hand of the majesty on high. And so Jesus is crowned with glory and honor because as a man representing humanity, he has regained the dominion that was forfeited through sin. When Christ comes into his kingdom, we will rule and reign with him. Crazy thought, but 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 12 says, if we endure, we will also reign with him. Revelation chapter 3, verse 21 says, he who overcomes, I will grant to have him sit with me on my throne, as I also overcame and sat down with my Father on his throne. Revelation 5, 9, and 10 said that Jesus is worthy to break the seals because he purchased men from every tribe and tongue and nation with his blood. He has made them to be a kingdom and a priest to our God, and they will reign upon the earth. So Jesus has restored humanity's condition. We will rule and reign once again, but in a greater sense, in a greater kingdom, the kingdom of Jesus Christ. And in verse 10, the author tells us the reason that Jesus had to suffer. He says it was fitting for him, for God the Father, in the course of bringing many sons to glory, to perfect the author of our salvation through suffering. Now, this word fitting, it means that it was right or it was proper that in restoring the glory of mankind, that Jesus would suffer. 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 23 says that the idea of a crucified Savior is a stumbling block to the Jews. And it's possible that the Hebrew recipients of this letter, they were struggling with the idea that their Savior died a cursed death on the cross. But the author here, he says that it was fitting, it was proper that salvation would come in this way. God's holiness demands perfection, which we clearly are unable to accomplish. So in order to satisfy God's justice, a perfect substitute was required. And so Jesus took on human flesh in order to be that perfect substitute. I mean, that part we understand. But then he makes this strange statement about Jesus being perfected. Jesus is the perfect Son of God. So what does he mean by Jesus being perfected? Was there some element of imperfection in him that needed to be worked out? No, certainly not. The idea is that he had to be tested or proven as the Son of Man. He is the perfect Son of God, but he had to be proven as the perfect Son of Man in order to represent man. To say that Jesus was sinless, and yet for him to never have to endure any of life's pains and difficulties and frustrations wouldn't be a fair assessment of his character, because that's not the reality that we experience in this life, is it? And we're still held to a perfect standard of holiness despite the circumstances that we have to encounter. Even though we're still plagued with a sin nature, when everything is going our way, it's fairly easy for us to be loving and patient and kind. When there's no difficulties, there's no frustrations to trigger what lurks beneath the surface, you know, we can do a pretty good impression of holy. But it's when we're put under trial that our true colors come out, right? All of a sudden, you know, pride and selfishness and anger and whatever other ugliness is in there, that gets exposed. And in order to represent humanity as the perfect substitute, Jesus had to endure the difficulties and the sufferings of living the human life. He had to prove his perfection. There had to be opportunity for him to fail, for him to sin just as Adam had sinned. Without that opportunity, it's a rigged game. Jesus took on human flesh to redeem and restore humanity. But in order to do that, he had to be perfect in the way that Adam and his descendants are not. He had to experience the human condition and remain sinless. And if you think about it, the proving of Jesus was much more difficult than the proving of Adam. I think we often think of it in the opposite way, like, oh, you know, Jesus had it easy. I mean, he was God. Of course he was perfect. Of course he was sinless. But with Adam, I mean, the deck was stacked in his favor. God placed him in a perfect environment. The human condition was free from sin because that contamination hadn't entered in yet, and still Adam failed. But with Jesus, he enters into the sin-soaked humanity and remains perfectly holy. And in that environment, Jesus proved himself to be our perfect substitute. You know, in his interactions with people, he never got frustrated or irritated. He never lost his temper. He proved himself in his perfect obedience. He never usurped the Father's will in favor of his own desires. He proved it all the way to the cross. He didn't curse the Father in his suffering. He didn't use his power as God to blunt the agony or to escape his suffering. He endured all of that to the end, demonstrating his perfection and really proving his worthiness as the suffering substitute. In explaining the incarnation, the author has pointed out that there was a pressing need. We were a fallen people. We were in a fallen condition. Jesus came as our suffering substitute, and now he addresses Jesus' acknowledged identity. Look again at verse 11. The first part of this verse is continuing the explanation of why it was fitting for Jesus to suffer. It was so that he could sanctify those who are sanctified. And then it transitions into this idea of Jesus identifying with humanity by saying that both Jesus and those whom he sanctifies are all from one Father. Now, you may have noticed that the word Father is in italics, or if you didn't, you can look down and see that the word Father is in italics in your Bible. That indicates that it's not in the original manuscripts. Father was inserted by the translators in an attempt to add clarity to the text. And most of the time, that's very helpful. But when they do that, they cross over from being translators and they become interpreters. And the grammar here is not straightforward, and it's debated as to what the one is actually referring to. Verse 11 says, "For both he who sanctifies and those who are sanctified are all from one." That word Father is not there. But like I said, the grammar isn't clear as to what that one actually is. And in the original language, this form for the word one, it can either be masculine or neuter. There's not the typical distinction in its spelling to make it clear. Normally, the word endings, they identify that for you. You know absolutely clear. This is neuter. This is masculine. This is feminine. But in this particular word, the same ending is used for both masculine and neuter. And so you have to make an interpretive decision as to which one it is. And that will help us understand what the one is referring to. So if you take it as masculine, then understanding this as saying we have one father fits, but the flow of thought isn't quite as clear. And so it would go something like this, starting up in verse 10. It would basically say, it was fitting for him, the Father, to perfect Jesus through suffering, because both Jesus who sanctifies and those who are sanctified are all from one Father. And so basically, Jesus had to suffer to sanctify because they're all from one Father. That argument doesn't really make a lot of sense. If you take it as a neuter, then it's referring to a thing. And that thing is humanity, flesh and blood. If you look down at verse 14, it says, therefore, since the children share in flesh and blood, he himself likewise also partook of the same. Jesus and those whom he sanctifies are all from one flesh and blood. And if you take it that way, the flow of thought is this. It was fitting for him, the Father, to perfect Jesus through suffering, since both Jesus who sanctifies and those who are sanctified are all from one flesh and blood, or from the same humanity. Now, the author is explaining the purpose of the incarnation. And the reason that Jesus had to take on human flesh and blood was so that he could sanctify humans who are of the same substance. He had to become as we are. He had to take on the full identity of humanity. And the author says that because of this identity, that Jesus is not ashamed to call them brethren. And he narrows down the everyone that Jesus tasted death for in verse 9. You know, that when we read that in verse 9, that's not a universal act for everyone's sake. In verse 10, Jesus suffered to bring many sons to glory. In verse 11, he sanctifies those who are sanctified. And so it's this specific group of glorified, sanctified individuals that Jesus identifies with as brothers. And if you are a believer, Jesus is not ashamed of you. He's not ashamed to be identified with you. That's incredible, because we all have shameful pasts, things that we wish we could dissociate ourselves with and that everybody would just forget about. But Jesus has identified himself with us and paid the penalty for our sin. He's given us his righteousness, sanctified us, making us holy. And so it's not that Jesus is unashamed of us in our shameful state. It's that he has taken our shame away. We are no longer bearing the shame before the Father. And the author demonstrates this from a couple of Old Testament examples. In verse 12, he cites a portion of Psalm 22. It's a psalm of God's deliverance. The first line is, my God, why have you forsaken me? And so we recognize these words as being on the lips of Christ on the cross. And the psalm contains other previews of the crucifixion. They pierced my hands and feet. It talks about casting lots for his clothes. And so it's a psalm that is obviously recognized as messianic, but it's a psalm of someone who is in anguish and crying out to the Lord for deliverance. And the section that the author of Hebrews quotes is towards the end of that, where the tone of the psalm changes. And now it's an exclamation of victory and joy because of the Lord's deliverance. Jesus, he endured the predicted torments of that psalm. He endured the suffering of the cross, but he was delivered out of death by the Lord. And in his victory, Jesus declares, verse 12, I will proclaim your name to my brethren. In the midst of the congregation, I will sing your praise. And the remainder of the psalm goes on to describe rejoicing and feasting. But this is not just a victory for Jesus. It's a victory that he has secured for his brothers because of his identity with them. He is victorious, and so they are victorious. In verse 13, he quotes from Isaiah chapter 8. In the historical context, it finds Israel and Syria. They're attempting to overthrow King Ahaz. He's the king of Judah. But God tells Ahaz, you know, he will not allow that to happen because God is going to be faithful to his covenant to maintain a descendant of David on the throne. And so again, the context is very messianic. God confirms his deliverance to Judah, or deliverance of Judah to Ahaz by giving the sign of the virgin birth. There's a mention of Emmanuel and how the Lord will become a sanctuary, but he will also be a stumbling block. You know, so all of these things are clearly predictive of Jesus, the Messiah. And it's in this context that Isaiah says, I will put my trust in him. And behold, I and the children whom God has given me. And so Isaiah is expressing faith in the Lord's promised deliverance out of the hands of Israel and Syria. And he's including the remnant of Jews who are also trusting in the Lord. And the author of Hebrews, he picks up on this messianic theme and attributes the same faith that Isaiah had to Jesus. Jesus went to the cross trusting in the deliverance of his Father, the promise of deliverance through suffering that would result in victory. But again, not just victory for himself, victory for his brothers as well. Victory for those whom he has identified himself with. And so the point here is not the victory itself. We'll get to some of the victory in a few minutes. The author is demonstrating the necessity of the incarnation of Jesus, because in that, he identifies with those whom he saves. He's not ashamed to call us brothers, and as brothers and sisters, we are identified with him in his holiness as the sanctifier and in his victory as the Savior. Well, as the author has been explaining the reasons behind the incarnation and the purpose of Jesus becoming a human, the benefits of what he accomplished have kind of come up in the background. But now the author highlights the glorious accomplishments of the incarnation. Look again at verse 14. He says, therefore, since the children share in flesh and blood, he himself likewise also partook of the same. So he's already explained that. Jesus took on humanity to identify with humanity. But then he says that through death he might render powerless him who had the power of death, that is the devil, and might free those who through fear of death were subject to slavery all their lives. And so the purpose of the incarnation was to neutralize the power of Satan and to liberate us from the fear of death. Now, Satan's power, it rests in sin. As soon as he convinced Adam and Eve to sin, they died. They immediately died spiritually, and they eventually died physically. And since all humanity has inherited the same sin nature and is born in sin, we are born both spiritually dead and have physical death and eternal judgment looming over us throughout our life. And the author calls this fear of death slavery. It holds humanity in bondage. And we can see evidence of the fear of death in many of the things that people do. If you think about all of the safety precautions and safety equipment that exists, I mean, some of it makes sense, but I think a lot of it is pretty ridiculous. It's there to protect you from something that has the probability of happening that is infinitesimally small. You know, helmets and safety glasses and elbow pads and knee pads and parachutes and airbags. I mean, my goodness, the poor kid just wants to ride his bike. Leave him alone. But there's just this fear that something is going to happen. And so we have to be safe. Now, obviously, we should be wise, but an overemphasis on safety is rooted in a fear of death. I think we can also see it when people overemphasize their health and basically have a religious devotion to their diet and exercise. I mean, obviously, we should be good stewards of our body, but some people take drastic measures to try and hold death at bay. Some go to extremes of medical science just to eke out an extra 3 days of life. You know, they cling to this life with everything they have. Why? Because of fear. And when that doesn't work, some with better means than me, they have turned to cryo storage. And they stick their brains or their bodies in liquid nitrogen and they freeze it in the hopes that at some point medical science will be able to thaw them out and bring them back to life. Humanity comes with an inherent fear of death, and not just the fear of exiting this life, but the fear of judgment that comes upon those as they enter the next life. You know, we don't want to leave what we love here, but we also don't want to face the judgment we know that we deserve. And Scripture teaches that unbelievers suppress the truth in unrighteousness. They know that there is a God and that they will have to deal with him upon their death. That truth is evident to all humanity. But the unbeliever ignores it. He tries to silence his troubled mind from even considering it. But when the reality of death creeps in, with it the fear that I'm going to have to face that judge. The author of Hebrews calls this fear of death a slavery that Satan holds over us. But Jesus has destroyed Satan's power and he has freed us from the fear of death. But critical to that is his incarnation. In the first part of verse 14, the author summarizes what he has explained earlier in the text. Jesus took on the same flesh and blood as humanity so that he could identify with us. Then, having identified with humanity in substance and experience, he was crucified as the perfect suffering substitute. His death broke the power of death because he paid the penalty of our sin for us. And without sin, there is no death. Now, that doesn't mean that we will never physically die. I mean, maybe we will, maybe we won't. I mean, that kind of just depends on when the Lord returns. But we will never experience the judgment of what Scripture refers to as the second death. Revelation chapter 21, verse 8, it describes those who are destined for judgment in hell. And it says, their part will be in the lake that burns with fire and brimstone, which is the second death. Those whom Jesus has freed have no need to fear this death. Revelation chapter 20, verse 6, talks about the resurrection of the saints at the beginning of the reign of Christ. And it says, blessed and holy is the one who has a part in the first resurrection. Over these, the second death has no power, but they will be priests of God and of Christ and will reign with him for 1,000 years. And so the incarnation of Jesus has resulted in the eradication of death and its associated fear for those who trust in him. In verse 16, the author brings the argument back around to angels. You know, Jesus, he doesn't help angels. There is no salvation for angels. Those that rebelled are forever condemned. And we saw in an earlier section that humanity was made, he was made a little lower than the angels, but clearly we are more valuable in the eyes of God than they are. Because God has redeemed and restored humanity, but he didn't do that for angels. And the author, he's not trying to tear angels down, or he's certainly not trying to puff us up with pride. He's just putting angels in their proper place in the eyes of his Hebrew audience. Since God does not help angels, then why are they holding them in such high regard? And since he does help mankind, and he did it through Jesus, there can be no turning away from this Jesus. In fact, it's Jesus who can help them in their temptation because he too has been tempted. And it's Jesus that can help us in our temptation, whatever those temptations may be. And the author frames up this help that Jesus gives us in a Jewish context. He draws an analogy to the Old Testament priesthood. And part of the function of priests was to stand before God as representatives of the people. They helped the people by assisting them in offering proper worship, and then when they fell into sin, they would help restore fellowship with God through sacrifices. And so the author says that Jesus became our high priest. But in order to do that, verse 17 says that he had to be made like his brothers in all things. And so, again, he's going back to the necessity of Jesus' identity with humanity. And in this case, his humanity makes it such that he is able to be our high priest. He represents us before the Father, and now he can make propitiation for the sins of God's people. And this word propitiation, it means to remove sin, and that's different than what the Old Testament priests could do. They could only cover over sin with the blood of sacrifices. Jesus offers a better priesthood and a better sacrifice. Now, both of which the author is going to flesh those out considerably more later in the letter. But for now, he's focusing on Jesus' identity with those whom he mediates for. Since Jesus has taken on full humanity and endured the sufferings of temptation, he is able to aid those who are being tempted. Verse 10 talked about the perfecting of Jesus through suffering. And that suffering included being tempted in every way so that he could be proven as the perfect sacrifice for our sins. Hebrews chapter 4, verse 15 says that he was tempted in all things as we are, yet without sin. Jesus endured temptation at a level that we don't even understand because he endured it all the way to its end, to the point where the temptation actually passes. When Jesus was tempted in the wilderness by Satan, the account in Luke chapter 4, verse 13 says, "When the devil had finished every temptation, he left him until an opportune time." And when I read that, it seems like Satan just got frustrated. Like he gave up. He was like, forget it. I'll try again later. Jesus endured every temptation to that point. When we are tempted and fail, the temptation stops at that point because we satisfy the temptation rather than fight against it. But Jesus fought every temptation to its end. He never failed. And so he understands the difficulty of temptation much better than we do. And because of that, he can help us in our temptations. We can go to him in prayer knowing that he understands our struggle. He is a sympathetic Savior. And by that, I don't mean he commiserates with us like, it's really tough. I think the Father's standards are a little too high. No. God's standards are just and right. But Jesus understands how difficult it is to live in a fallen world and how difficult it is to do battle with the desires of our flesh. So we can look to him as our model to be encouraged and strengthened, to see that it is possible to overcome these temptations. It can be done. Jesus took on humanity to prove that it can be done. He has gone before us, defeating sin and death, and given us his righteousness and filled us with the power of his Spirit so that we too can overcome temptation. And then if we fail, he is a merciful and faithful high priest, sympathetic to our weakness, and able to completely remove our sin. The incarnation of Jesus takes on a whole new understanding when you look at it as the author of Hebrews has explained it for us. The incarnation of Jesus is more than just a baby in a manger. It demonstrates the greatness of God and illustrates the reason that he is so worthy of our praise. I hope he has been magnified in your heart this morning as he has mine. Let's pray. Oh, Lord, you are glorious. Just what you have accomplished and your great love for us. We certainly do not deserve it, and we can never merit it. But as we look deeper into who it is that you are and what it is that you've done for us, our hearts are swelling with just love and desire for you. And I pray, Lord, that you would encourage us this week, that you would be with us as we go out into a sin-filled world, and that you would help us with temptation, that when temptations come our way, that we would look to you as having gone before us and overcome, that you would strengthen us with your Spirit to not give in to temptation. And Lord, should we fail, help us to be quick to come back to your grace and to admit our failure, to fall upon your sacrifice. And I pray, Lord, that if there's anyone here this morning that doesn't know you, has never really considered you and what it is that you did, all they maybe know is, you know, a Christmas story or something like that. Lord, I pray that your word has pierced their heart and that it has given them spiritual life, that you would draw them to yourself and give them repentance and faith. It's in your name that we pray. Amen.
Amen. I invite you to stand with us. Let's stand all together and sing about Jesus, the blessed assurance.
Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Heir of salvation, the purchase of God. Born of his Spirit, washed in his blood. This is my story, this is my song. Praising my Savior.
Could I ask you to please take your seats? We're going to take care of some business. Thank you, Adam, by the way, first of all, for teaching us again the necessity of the incarnation, that the Lord Jesus came to restore the glory and honor to fallen man, to become the substitute for our sin, to grant us victory, and then to free us from the fear of death. How important that is for every one of us. And praise God that he did come to this earth to redeem us. Well, before we conclude, I do want to announce our new members who have completed the membership process. As you may have known, in June we had our classes, and then we couldn't announce them earlier because of certain things, but today we want to announce the rest of the members who have completed the membership process. Why is it important to become a member? Well, first of all, in Hebrews chapter 13 and 17, it does tell us that the leaders or the elders of a church, they shepherd souls, and they will give an account to those who are allotted to their charge. So as leaders of a church, they need to know who exactly are they shepherding. So who are the people that belong to the church? Not only that, but also there's the concept of accountability and also using your gift to minister to others. So when people want to minister within the church, the church needs to know that this person is actually a true believer. He's accountable to the elders. He's a member. And so membership is very important. And we see it throughout Scripture that there is the principle of belonging to a church, adding numbers to the church. So we have that process to become a member. And to become a member, you have to fill out an application and then have a pastoral interview, go to classes. And the people that I'm about to announce have completed all of that process. Now, I know some of you have already come up to me and said, hey, when is the next membership classes? We're ready to go. And since we just completed them in June, our next cycle will be in September. Here's what we're going to do. From now on, we'll have three membership cycles every year. So it'll be in January, in May, and then in September. So if you miss the September classes, the whole process, you will have to wait till January of 2023. So if you are interested in becoming a member, please come see me. I'll give you some instructions, some directions. There's an application on our website, the statement of faith, what we teach document, our bylaws. All of that needs to be read, needs to be filled out. Well, let me call out your name. And as I call out your name, please come to the front. And I would ask you to just line up over here in front and face me. Anastasia Dronov. Angelina Dronov. Georgie Dronov. Katya Dronov. Andrew Iglesias, Leah Iglesias, Daniel Lameka, and Yana Lameka. We have an opportunity to affirm your commitment to the church before all of us. So I'm going to ask you some questions, and then I want you to affirm with, I will. Will you be diligent to exercise self-control so that your lifestyle exhibits true Christian love and personal holiness?
I will.
Will you take seriously your relationship to others in the body of Christ, striving to maintain unity and doing all you can to stimulate in others to love and to do good works?
I will.
Will you faithfully assemble with the body of believers and exercise your spiritual gifts in faithfully serving fellow saints in the Gospel of Grace Community Church?
I will.
Will you teach biblical truths to your own family and friends as God gives you opportunity to evangelize those who do not know Christ?
I will.
Will you be willing to give and to receive admonition and instructions with meekness and love?
I will.
Will you be vigilant, praying for leaders, elders, and deacons here at Gospel of Grace Church?
I will.
Will you commit to praying for the ministry here in the church, for all of our brothers and sisters, and for all the lost who need the Savior?
I will.
Thank you. Well, we receive you as gifts from the Lord. Congregation, I want to ask all of you now to also rise, and I want to ask you to respond to this question with your affirmation. Will you, as a congregation, with the aid of the Holy Spirit, seek to love, encourage, teach, admonish, comfort, exhort these new folks and embrace them and make them a part of your own life in a genuine desire to see them grow in grace and knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ?
I will.
Let's go ahead and pray, and then I invite all of you to come and welcome our new members. Heavenly Father, we thank you that you are building your church. Thank you that you're bringing gifted saints to gospel of grace to use their gifts to edify this body. Father, I pray that each one of us would be faithful in our responsibilities. May we love and care for one another. May we keep each other accountable, encouraging one another, helping each other grow in the knowledge and truth of who you are. Lord, I pray that your will would be done, Gospel of Grace Church, that we would seek to honor you in everything that we do, that the main purpose of everything that we would do would be to glorify your holy name. So, Lord, we pray that all of our saints would be edified so that we would also be useful in your hand to call others to Christ. We thank you for the reminder today that Jesus came to this earth to restore our glory and honor, to become our substitute, to grant us victory, and then to free us from the fear of death. And Lord, we can rejoice and praise you for this glorious promise. Lord, may we go out today having this hope of eternal life, living our life for your glory and honor, being diligent to be holy in this earth, on this life. And we thank you and praise you for all these things. It's in Christ's name we pray. Amen.